Thank you, Whitney and David and Wesley. That was beautiful. God used your talents to remind us that even in these difficult days, we have so much to praise Him for. The beauty of our world, the beauty of this hour of worship, and especially for His love that unites us. Didn't you all hear those words in your minds as they played? Now, you know what I'm preaching today in the sanctuary from behind the pulpit under the good old hot lights I used to be under every week. I'm doing that to give Matt Jenkins some practice and using the new video equipment so we'll be ready when we do reopen our campus, hopefully in a few more weeks. Just stay tuned and keep praying to that end. I want to begin my message today, though, with an old story. So here goes. 9 GIs were on a weekend pass, and they failed to show up at the Monday morning roll call. Their colonel was furious. I mean, the first man didn't show up until 7 p.m. Now, when he did, he explained, he said, "I'm sorry, sir, but I had a date. I lost track of time and I missed the bus back. However, being determined to get back to base on time, I hired a cab. But halfway here, the cab broke down. So I walked to a nearby farmhouse and I convinced the farmer to sell me a horse. I was riding the horse to camp when the animal just fell over dead. I have walked the last 10 miles and I just got here." Well, the colonel was somewhat skeptical, but he let the man off with a reprimand. However, after him, 7 other stragglers in a row came in with the exact same story. Had a date, missed the bus, hired a cab, bought a horse, it died, walked the rest of the way back. Well, by the time the 9th guy reported in, the colonel, of course, had pretty much had it. So with a lot of anger in his voice, he said, "Well, what happened to you?" And the GI said, "Sir, I had this date, and I missed the bus, so I hired a cab." "Wait, wait, wait," the colonel said. "Don't tell me the cab broke down." The soldier said, "No, sir, the cab didn't break down. It was just that there were so many dead horses in the road, we had trouble getting through." Now, I'll pause to allow you to laugh. Still pausing. Okay, I think that's enough. My excuse for sharing this old joke is because the hero of the faith that we're looking at today, Moses, well, he is known for his excuses. Excuses as to why he couldn't do the task that God called him to do. So open your Bibles to Exodus chapters 3 and 4 and keep them open there. That's where we find the record of this part of Moses' life. Okay, now we need to review Moses' story a bit because we often make excuses when God calls, don't we? And as George Bernard Shaw warns, excuses are the cradle that Satan rocks men off to sleep in. Good warning. Now, as I'm sure you'll remember, Moses was originally a literal prince of Egypt. Thanks to God's miraculous intervention, the Pharaoh's daughter found and adopted baby Moses when he was floating in that basket, and then raised and educated him as part of the royal family. The Bible tells us that when Moses grew up and he saw the misery of his people who labored under the cruelty of the Egyptian slave masters, well, he took matters into his own hands one day and murdered an Egyptian who was beating a Hebrew. When the Pharaoh found out about this, he tried to kill Moses. So Moses fled and went to live in Midian, where he married a woman named Zipporah and started a family. He worked there as a shepherd, tending the flocks of his father-in-law Jethro for 40 years. And then on an ordinary day, a day like so many others, God's call came to him. I mean, no angel appeared, you know, stopped by to tap Moses on the shoulder the night before and say, "Hey, Mo, pay attention tomorrow because God is going to be talking to you. And by the way, take my advice, keep your eye out for unique bushes." No, there were absolutely no hints, no premonitions, no special signs to alert him to the fact that God himself was about to show up and change Moses' life forever. It was just a common, ordinary, garden variety day shift on Mount Horeb while he was taking care of his father-in-law's sheep. And I stress this because that's often how God works. Without warning, he speaks to ordinary people, people like me and people like you on ordinary days. I mean, God could speak to us tomorrow. You could be wearing your favorite face mask while you shop for groceries, being sure to go up the right way on a cereal aisle at Giant when God speaks to you. You could be at the sink washing your hands, counting up to 20, as you've done countless other times these past couple months, when God speaks to you. The point is, the ordinary routines of life are each potential Mount Horebs for you and me. And as I said, that's how it happened for Moses. This 80-year-old shepherd was kicking his sandals in the sand, just like he'd done on countless other days, watching the sheep eat and baa and bleat, when he noticed a very extraordinary thing, a common desert scrub brush on fire. And of course, that in itself wasn't all that odd. I mean, like all shepherds, Moses had seen lightning strike a scrub brush and ignite it all the time. But this brush fire was unique because it didn't burn out. The bush didn't dissolve into smoke and ashes like it always did before. No, it kept burning with a consistent blaze. This, of course, made Moses curious, so he went over to investigate. Well, this is also part of God's method. See, many times on ordinary days, he does extraordinary things to get our attention. He does something to intrude into our routine and say, wait. So we'll say, wait a minute, you know. He'll say, wait a minute, listen, stop what you're doing and listen, because I have something important to say to you. In fact, take my advice here. Whenever we go through an unusual event, it'd be very wise for us to ask, is God trying to tell me something here? What's God trying to teach me in all this that is going on? And I want you to be sure and note when it was that God spoke to Moses. He spoke to him only after Moses turned aside. Look at chapter 3, verse 4. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. In fact, let's turn aside and do a little self-evaluation right now. Let's ask ourselves, how good am I at turning aside? How hard is it for my Heavenly Father to get my attention? In fact, let me strongly suggest that we all do our best to learn the discipline of regularly, daily turning aside, taking a moment each day to listen to God, because as I said last week, He really does speak to us. I confess, I've wondered if perhaps God allowed this COVID-19 pandemic to come to us because He had something important to say, and He knew that virus would finally get our attention. What do you think about that? Could God have allowed this disease to come so that people would finally turn to Jesus? Could He have allowed COVID to hit so we could hear Him saying things like, you people need to stop being so selfish. You need to learn to help others, especially you Christians. Perhaps a common enemy will teach you to work together to do that, work together to help people in need. You know, I love the news story I heard about a nursing home in Newark, Ohio. Did you hear this one? Back in March, the staff saw that COVID was coming. They saw what COVID was doing to other facilities like their own. And so they locked their doors. And every member of that staff stayed inside that building 65 days, caring for their patients to make sure that they did not have any contact with the outside world. Those staff people slept on the floor in their offices. They ate the same food as the other people did. And they made sure supplies were left outside the door before they brought it in. I mean, they were determined that their patients would not get this disease. And it worked. Not a single elderly resident did. I know their selfless actions working together pleased God. It always pleases Him when we love like that, sacrificially putting others first. Back to Moses, though. He saw this burning bush and he turned aside, and when he did, he came face to face with his destiny. Look at verse 7. God says, I've been watching the situation. I'm aware of what's been happening. I've seen my people weeping in the night. I've heard the crack of the whip and the cries of the little ones. I've seen the bodies alongside the road or flung into the Nile like so many beasts of burden. None of this escapes my notice, Moses, and I'm going to do something about it. And I'm sure Moses thought, great, God, it's about time. But he probably felt fairly neutral about things at this point because in his mind, this thing that God was going to do, this great thing, well, in his mind, it didn't involve him. Remember, Moses had never read the book of Exodus, so he didn't know what God was about to say. Well, as he was glowing in the joy that God was finally going to free his people, Moses heard the words that would change his life forever. As in verse 10, God said this, therefore come now, and I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you may bring my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. And in my mind, Moses did sort of a double take at that point and said, What did you say, God? Could you repeat that last part? I mean, me? You're sending me? I mean, it was as if God were to come to you or come to me today and say, I've heard the cries of people of color in America, people who have suffered the pain of racism all their lives, and I'm going to do something about that. And we would respond by thinking, great, it's about time. And then God would continue and say, the something I'm going to do is use you. Now, before you scoff, listen, I think God is speaking to us. He's telling us it is time for each of us to do our part to end racial injustice. God is talking to those of us who have said and done nothing, those who have not taken the time to try and understand how and why our friends of color have been and still are hurting deeply. God is speaking to all of us. The question is, are we listening? If not, I would ask, what else does God have to do to get our attention so we will turn aside and listen and heed and obey? Well, Moses' realization that God set him apart for this overwhelming task, of course, it bowled him over, which led to his pile of excuses, those things I mentioned. You know, excuses that really can be summarized in two questions that he asked God. And the first is in verse 11, where Moses asked, who am I? Who am I that I should do this? And I think the thoughts that went through his mind at this point might have gone somewhat like this. I can't do this, God. I'm a failure. Why, I still work for my father-in-law. I'm a loser. On top of that, I'm a convicted murderer. If I go down there, I'll be arrested and executed right away. Plus, I can't walk into Pharaoh's royal court in this outfit smelling like sheep. I'm not so old that I've forgotten how those kind of people look at shepherds. Why, the Pharaoh will laugh so hard he'll fall off his throne before I even get a chance to say anything. Sure, I used to be important, but now I'm a nobody. And don't forget, I tried this deliverance thing 40 years ago, and I was neither believed nor listened to. Why should the people of Israel listen to me now? Why me, Lord? Basically, Moses' first pile of excuses added up to the fact that he felt inferior. He felt like a failure. And the Bible also tells us that he felt incapable. In verse 4, chapter 10, he added to his excuse pile by saying, oh Lord, I'm not one of those guys who can sell refrigerators at the North Pole. I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you've spoken to your servant. Now, this was not entirely true. Acts 7 says that earlier in Moses' life, you know, back in the days when he was the prince of Egypt, he was, quote, educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and action. But that was half a lifetime ago. At this point, Moses felt washed up. In his mind, he was a has-been, nothing more than an old shepherd. His current skills in public speaking were limited to the words and sounds that were used to motivate sheep, not people, not a nation, not a pharaoh. Moses summed it all up in verse 13 by saying, I'm not as qualified as others. Send someone else. And here's one time I really like the Modern Language Bible's translation. It has Moses saying, oh Lord, please send anyone else. Basically, Moses said, no matter how you look at it, God, I'm not qualified. So why give me this task? Makes no sense. Surely you understand that I should be excused. Well, you and I need to pay close attention to this because so many times we excuse ourselves from answering God's call. We do it with the same basic rationale. We think, why me? I'm not talented enough. I'm just not able to do this, God. I can't really make a difference. Well, listen, friends, our talents or lack of them are not an issue when it comes to accomplishing God's will, whether it involves sharing our faith with a perfect stranger or standing up for justice in this and fairness in this fallen world of ours. The fact is, Moses' sin and guilt and limitations and shortcomings were no longer the ultimate truth here because, like Gideon, God would be with Moses. Listen, friends, when it comes to doing His will in this world, God's not looking for extraordinary people. He's looking for ordinary people like you and me who will trust in an extraordinary God. It's as Paul puts it in 2 Corinthians 4, we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God, not from us. I like how Swindoll puts it. He says, any old bush will do as long as God is in the bush. Now, I hope you graduates hear this. All we have to do to make a difference in this world for God is be available. To keep with that bush metaphor, all we have to do is be flammable. God is saying, Moses, I want you to burn for me like no man has burned before. I want you to be my burning bush. You've been dried out and well seasoned to this howling wasteland for the past 40 years. But that's how I wanted you, dried out, because now you can burn with my presence and power. Well, God is still looking for people like Moses, available, dried out people who will say, I'm here, Lord, I'm yours, thorns and all, set me afire. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. You know, I love this lyric I came across a few years ago. It's written by Amy Carmichael. She says, give me the love that leads the way, the faith that nothing can dismay, the hope no disappointments tire, the passion that will burn like fire. Let me not sink to be a clod. Make me thy fuel, O flame of God. Isn't that beautiful? Well, God's response to Moses' first excuse set up his second set of excuses to pile up as he said, well, okay then, well, who are you? Look at Exodus 3:13. Moses says, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? They will ask, which God are you talking about? Well, who are you? What shall I tell them? In other words, Moses reversed his first question. First he said, who am I that you would send me? And now Moses asked, who are you that you would send I? And God's answer to this question was almost as dramatic as the burning bush itself. Look at verse 14. God says, I am who I am, Moses. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. Tell them, I am has sent me to you. And these two words, I am, God was telling Moses that he is the eternally existing one, the one and only, always present to help his people. And then with the miracle of changing Moses' rod into a snake and back into a rod and giving Moses leprosy and then healing him, God showed Moses that he had the power to do what needed doing. So Moses had no excuse to say no. All Moses had to do was to yield his life to God's direction, and the unlimited, all-sufficient power of God would flow through him, meeting his every need as he led the people of Israel out of bondage into the promised land. Well, the same is true for you and me. Our sufficiency for any task that we're given by God is not found within ourselves, but in God himself. This is why Oswald Chambers once said, beware of any work for God which enables you to avoid concentration on him. There's only one way to develop spiritually, and that is by concentration on God. You know, Samaritan's Purse, that Christian medical relief organization that set up the field hospital in Central Park to treat COVID patients, it was founded originally by a man named Bob Pierce. Bob went all over the world serving God by delivering people from hunger and disease, and he learned to practice what he called God room. This is when you commit yourself to doing bigger things than you can humanly do. In other words, you give God Almighty room to work. You rely on his power, not your own. And I love that. Remember, doing God's will is not based on our resources. Doing God's will simply means we rely on the nature of I am, who can do above and beyond what we ask or even imagine. You know, the interesting thing about this passage is that it doesn't tell us what happened to that burning bush. We find out what happened to Moses and what happens to the children of Israel. We find out what happens to Pharaoh and his troops, etc. But we never find out what happened to that bush. And we don't because I think there's a sense in which it is still burning. God is still waiting for people to turn aside. I think God's waiting for that right now as you listen. So would you do that? Would you turn aside with me now and let's pray? Father God, speak to us. Your servants are listening. Burn in and through us, Father. Use us as your hands and feet and heart and voice. Use us to help the hurting of the world. Use us to bring our friends and neighbors to faith in Jesus so that hearts will be changed. Set the people of Redland afire, Father. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you are watching for the first service, I would encourage you to stick around for our grace group time this morning at 10:30, because we'll hear interviews from our high school graduates, and then we'll see a slide presentation of their lives throughout the years. And I would remind you, tonight we have a business meeting, a Zoom one, so if you haven't gotten the link, check your newsletter, it's in there. And then I would also let you know that this Saturday there will be a march for racial reconciliation, a march against racial injustice that's led by the pastors of evangelical churches in our area. And you are welcome to join in. I'll send details this week. Now say it with me, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And this week, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through Him.